بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. السلام عليك سيدي ومولاي يا رسول الله. السلام عليك سيدي ومولاي يا أمير المؤمنين. السلام عليك سيدتي ومولاتي يا زهراء. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين. Salutations be upon Imam Hussein. Salutations be upon Ali ibn al-Husayn. Salutations be upon the children of Husayn. And salutations be upon the companions of Imam Husayn. Dear brothers and sisters, on the 10th day of Muharram, in the land of Karbala, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, where he stood addressing the enemies of Allah, reminding them of their duties. On his side were companions committed to Imam Hussein. But after the noon, after what happened, after the battle, Imam Hussein would stand on the plains of Karbala, calling, Ala min mughithi yughithuna, ألا من ناصر ينصرنا. Anyone there to aid us? Anyone there to help us? Anyone there to bring and be victorious to us? Dear brothers and sisters, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, on the plains of Karbala, calling so the souls would be awakened, so the hearts would listen, so the minds would remember. Ya laytana kunna ma'ankum sadati fanafuz fawzan azima. Ya حبيبي حسين نور نور عيني حسين. The light of my eyes حسين. The love of my heart حسين. We wish we were with you in the land of Karbala on the 10th day of Muharram.
Salawat. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له والصلاة والسلام على النبي الهاشمي المدني الأبطحي التهامي السيد البهي السراج المضيء الكوكب الدري صاحب الوقار صاحب الرسول الأعظم صلى الله عليه وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. رسول الله صاحب الوقار والسكينة ذاك المدفون بالمدينة العبد المؤيد الرسول المسدد المصطفى الأمجد المحمود الأحمد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Allah the Almighty said in the Holy Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وعد الله الذين آمنوا منكم وعملوا الصالحات ليستخلفنهم في الأرض كما استخلف الذين من قبلهم وليمكنن لهم دينهم الذي ارتضى لهم وليبدلن خوفهم أمنا وليمكنن لهم دينهم الذي ارتضى لهم وليبدلن خوفهم أمنا يعبدونني لا يشركون بي شيئا ولا يبدلنهم بعد خوفهم أمنا يعبدونني لا يشركون بي شيئا
ذلك فأولئك هم الفاسقون. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات
Dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As we continue in another night, another gathering, we try to live the tragedy of Karbala to learn from what happened on the 10th day of Muharram in the land of Karbala. And as we have been building up in the past few nights, we came to the point that what has been happening and the reason for which Imam Hussein alayhi salam was martyred in the land of Karbala, as he continues the call of all the Imams, of all the Prophets alayhi salam, if from our father Adam alayhi salam, continuing it through Ibrahim alayhi salam to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. To protect that knowledge, to protect that message, because the message is the knowledge. And the purpose for the messengers that were sent one after the other, one following the other, is to protect that message of Allah Azza wa Jal, to protect that knowledge that was given and passed on. Now, we come to today, the time of the 12th Holy Imam Salamullahi Ta'ala Alayhi, Al-Imam Al-Hujja Al-Muntadhar Ajjalallahu Ta'ala Farajahu Al-Sharif, through which this verse Allah says, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah has promised those amongst you who believe and do good deeds. وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. At the end, He will certainly give them that authority, that khilafah on earth. Allah says, كَمَا اسْتَخْلَفَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ, as He did to those before them. وَلَيُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمْ. Now this is important. لَيُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمْ. And He certainly will establish for them their religion. This establishment of religion, this protection of religion, because the real knowledge is the knowledge of the religion. And you will see that Allah Azza wa Jal, throughout time, when He sent the prophets, is to protect that for the purpose of that religion. And Allah Azza wa Jal, when He talks and promises in the Holy Quran that there this one day that will come, and when it comes, it will be delivered. Then the question is, what is that day? Al-Imam Salamullahi Ta'ala Alayhi, Al-Imam Sadiq Alayhi Salam says, إِنَّ ذَلِكَ فِي يَوْمِ ظُهُورِ قَائِمِ آلِ مُحَمَّدٍ. That is the day, the appearance of the 12th Holy Imam Salamullahi Ta'ala Alayhi. That is the day that the religion will be established for us, and Allah will replace after the fear with what? Amnan. He will replace for us the fear with peace. And we ought to realize this, that Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in many different places in the Holy Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَيَقُولُونَ مَتَى هَذَا الْفَتْحُ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. When will be this conquest if you are honest and truthful? What is that conquest? قُلْ يَوْمَ الْفَتْحِ لَا يَنْفَعُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِيمَانُهُمْ وَلَا هُمْ يُنْظَرُونَ. On that day, the day of conquest, the belief of those who had disbelieved will not benefit them, and they will be reprived. فَأَعْرِضْ عَنْهُمْ وَانْتَظِرْ إِنَّهُمْ مُنْتَظِرُونَ. So turn away from them and wait. Indeed, they're waiting. We have so many different places in the Holy Quran, dear brothers and sisters, when we are asked about that day. Al-Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, when he was asked about Yawm al-Fath, that day, what day is the Quran talking about? Al-Imam salamullahi ta'ala alayhi says, هُوَ يَوْمُ الْفَتْحِ يَوْمَ تُفْتَحُ الدُّنْيَا عَلَى الْقَائِمِ. The day this world will be open to our 12th Holy Imam. And in another verse, Allah says, هَلْ يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَّا أَن تَأْتِيَهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَوْ يَأْتِيَ رَبُّكَ أَوْ يَأْتِيَ بَعْضُ آيَاتِ رَبِّكَ. Do they then wait for anything except that the angels should come to them, or your Lord, or should come to that, there come some of the signs of your Lord? When the Imam alayhi salam also was asked about the signs of the Lord, he said, this is the time of the appearance of the 12th Holy Imam salamullahi ta'ala alayhi. You see, dear brothers and sisters, many things revolve around the appearance of the 12th Holy Imam alayhi afdhalus salatu wassalam. And you will realize that that day of appearance is an important day for all of us. And we claim that we are trying to prepare for his appearance. But in order for us to be successful in our project and to achieve our goals and objectives, if you ever go into management and into project management, they tell you whenever you have a project, it tries to sit back and try to vision and get an image of the end product before you start your project. Try to see how do you want your end product to look like. Imagine it. Once you imagine it, you'll have a clearer picture and a better approach to what is it you want to achieve. The question is, and let's be very frank, that when we look at many of the presentations, when we talk about the 12th Holy Imam, what are we talking about? Most of the time, it is projected as a war, as a battle, and that there is a battle being taking place, and there is a war that is taking place, and there is a military confrontation. And then, in that military confrontation, there be a lot of killing, and there will be some who lose and one who wins. It's always presented and pictured in a way that there is a war. And there is this battle that is going to take place, and there are these armies, and there is a winner and a loser. It's projected in a way of a military victory. Now, let's go further. Some, as I listen and as I hear and I read a lot of the forums, a lot of the blogs, a lot of the emails, we depict this war between the falsehood and the truth, as the Imam alayhi salam is of course the one who takes the banner of the truth against falsehood, and we show what happens on that day. And to prep it, there's a lot of emphasis on the military aspect of it. And we show there will be some miracles taking place. And we depicted that at one point that somehow everyone will follow the Imam alayhi salam. And we picture it in a way that everyone will be on one side. And if there is any enemies, they will be dissolved. They will be removed. They will be taken care of. They will no longer exist. Right or wrong? I mean, isn't that the picture that you get? Right? Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Let me ask you, did the prophets alayhim salam use the military might to overtake those who disagreed with them? Did they kill the enemy just because the enemies were in disagreement with them? Allah Azza wa Jal, look at the verse, says Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And I want you to think with me as I present you these verses, because after all, the Quran is the one that will guide us. He says, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ. It is He who sent His Messenger with guidance and the religion of truth. لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. To manifest it over all religion. وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ. Although they who associate others with Allah dislike it. What is this telling us? That disbelievers, those who associate with Allah, will dislike something. That thing is what? When Allah Azza wa Jal will manifest the religion above and over all. Even if the disbelievers dislike it. What do we learn from this verse? As if Allah is telling us there will be a point in time that whether the disbelievers like it or dislike it, religion that is chosen by Allah will prevail over all. That's one thing. In another place, another verse in Surah Al-Fath, Allah says the same, very like to the first verse, which was mentioned in Surah Tawbah, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى. He is the one who sent his prophet with the guidance, وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ, and the true religion. For what purpose? لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. Again, to manifest it over all religion. That shows that Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah, when He gave the prophets alayhim salam this religion, it will prevail over all. And then Allah says, وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا. And sufficient is Allah as witness. Does it stop there? No, further on. Allah says, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, هُوَ الَّذِي, in Surah Al-Saff, Allah Azza wa Jal says, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. The same exact message, that Allah will prevail His religion over all and over everyone. Here Allah says, وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ. Even if the disbelievers dislike it. So here, what I hear when Allah Azza wa Jal talks about all of this in the verses, that when religion prevails, there will be a group that dislikes this. So what comes to mind, it doesn't mean everyone will be following this religion and everyone will submit and everyone will say, yes, you're right. No, there will be a group that dislikes it. But although they dislike it, what happens to the religion of truth? It will prevail. Okay? So now, I'm trying to change some of the myths we have about the appearance of the 12th Holy Imam alayhi salam. One of the most prevalent ones, the ones that we always hear, that the Imam alayhi salam, when he appears, the Imam salamullahi ta'ala alayhi, when he appears, everyone will change, everyone will turn, and everyone will follow the religion of Islam. And besides that, that everyone will follow the religion of Islam whether they like it or not. Let's read further. Allah Azza wa Jal, in an earlier verse, He says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Look at this. يُرِيدُونَ لِيُطْفِئُوا نُورَ اللَّهِ. They want to extinguish the light of Allah. What is the light of Allah? It is that knowledge that was sent to us. It is the knowledge that presents the love of Ahlul Bayt, the love of Allah, the following of the wilayah of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, all of these issues. The principles that Allah Azza wa Jal sent to us. بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ. They want to extinguish the light of Allah with their mouths. وَاللَّهُ مُتِمُّ نُورِهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ.
But Allah will perfect, will complete that light, although the disbelievers dislike it. This strengthens the notion that whether the disbelievers, whether the opposing parties like it or not, the religion of truth will prevail. Furthermore, Allah Azza wa Jal says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَأَغْلِبَنَّ أَنَا وَرُسُلِي إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ. Allah has ordained, has written, I will surely overcome, I and my messengers. Indeed, Allah is all-powerful, is exalted in might. When I read all of these verses, it shows that Allah, with His power, with His might, at the end, whether anyone likes it or not, what will prevail? That religion of truth will prevail. Now, the notion that I get from, again, I want to emphasize this, listening to lecturers, listening to speakers, reading, whether it's in the blogs, in the forums, in the emails, about the might of the army of the Imam alayhi salam, how the army of the Imam will change the face of the earth, how the army of the Imam will knock things down, no one can stand before him, how the army of the Imam, how the might of the Imam, how it's all focused on that battle. Okay, interesting. For a second, all of this sounds very interesting. Why? Because if I read the Quran, I tend to think a little bit differently. I would have a conflict here. Allah in the Holy Quran says in Surah Al-Baqarah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من الغي. There shall be no compulsion in accepting religion. The right course has become clear from the wrong course. فمن يكفر بالطاغوت, until the end of the verse. But here, there is an emphasis, there is no compulsion in religion. Hold on. There is no compulsion in religion, but we keep on talking about wars and the military might. Allah Azza wa Jal tells us, أَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ, direct yourself towards this religion, لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا, submitting to the truth. فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا. This is the fitra, the way you're created and all were created on. لا تبديع لخلق الله. There is no change in the creation of Allah. Dear brothers and sisters, let me ask you this question. When do people use force and or violence? When is it, if I have an idea, and you have an idea, if I wasn't able to convince you of my idea, and you were open-minded, but I failed to convince you, but I want you to believe in what I believe, what do I do then? I try to use force. I try to change, or I try to subdue you with the force. Why? Because I am weak. My idea is weak. I wasn't able to change your mind. I use that force. I don't have any other weapon. I lost the battle of the mind with you. لا إكراه. See, there is one thing about religion. No matter, you can force 1, 2, 100, 1,000, even 1,000,000 people to do things you like. They might appear as
they were changed, but you've never changed their hearts. You can force them to do something, but you never captured their heart. Where do you think religion lies? Where do you think religion rests? Religion rests deep in the heart. And that is one place no one can tamper with. No one can have compulsion in. I can act as if I like what you say. I'll clap to you. I'll say salawat for you. I'll follow you. But deep inside of my heart, I hate you. Deep inside of my heart, I mock you. Deep inside of my heart, I disrespect you. Allah Azza wa Jal, dear brothers and sisters, when He sent this religion, He sent the religion for the heart. Because let me tell you, in the past few nights, what have I been saying? I've been emphasizing on one thing. The ideas that build you. And where do you start building? You understand it. That understanding motivates you. Then, do you remember when I talked about the intellect and the theoretical intellect and the applied intellect? That applied intellect moves none other than the heart. The heart is the place where the idea finds its place. And when the idea takes hold of the heart, no one can change it. You will fight for it. You will die for it. You'll be like Al-Hur. You will be like Habib ibn Mudahir. You'll be like Zuhair ibn Al-Qayn. You'll be like Muslim ibn Awsaja. You'll be like Abbas. You'll be like all these individuals that committed themselves. Why? Because the love of Hussein rested right in their heart. The hadith says that Allah told the Prophet, "My heavens and earth could not encompass me, but the heart of the believer could." How? When we love Him, when we fall in love with Him. And the encompass is not that we know of Him, but we believe in Him. Dear brothers and sisters, there is one place in this universe that is free, that cannot be enslaved: your hearts. There is the companions of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam were many. They were many. And Muawiyah tried to go after each and every one of them. And he tried it through his spies, it through his money, it through threatening. And if you read, and it's beautiful to read the history of Imam Ali alayhi salam's companions and see what they do and what happened to them. See what happened to Malik al-Ashtar. See what happened to Hijr. See what happened to Abu al-Aswad al-Du'ali. See what happened to all of these individuals and many others. Why? You'll find that all of them were engaged, number one, with giving knowledge, number one. They were all, yes, they were warriors. Some were merchants. Some were craftsmen. Each one worked in different fields, but they were all scholars. And you will see that the Imam salamullahi ta'ala alayh, at his time, when he sent them throughout the different places, at the time, he asked the people to depend on them, to take knowledge from them. Now, one of them was Abu al-Aswad al-Du'ali. Muawiyah wanted to get this Abu al-Aswad al-Du'ali, one of the companions of Imam Ali alayhi salam. Muawiyah wanted to get it to his side. Muawiyah sent him things, gifts, You know, you want to take care of someone, you want to get someone's attention, you send him or her a gift. A gift is a message. Sometimes it's an innocent message. Sometimes it's a political message. Every time you receive something, you ask why. The brothers, when they tahadu tahabu, give gifts to each other, this is how you strengthen the care and love amongst each other. It's very important. Dear brothers and sisters, how do people get to each other's heart? One of them is through these gifts. Muawiyah sent these very important, these very expensive gifts to Abu al-Aswad. Amongst them, there was some sweets. The daughter of Abu al-Aswad, Du'ali, she goes and she wants to grab one of the sweets to eat it. Abu al-Aswad tells her, hold back. She goes, what's wrong? He said, this was sent by Muawiyah. Look at how we raise our children. Look at how the lovers of Ahlul Bayt raise their children. She took it and she threw it away. She said to her father, he thinks he can buy us through sweets, and the love of Ali can be taken from our hearts. Dear brothers and sisters, what does it mean to you, the love of Ali? What does it mean to you, the love of Ahlul Bayt, alayhi salam? And that is the love of religion. That is the definition of religion. Innama ad-deen, this religion is all about love. But what love? Loving those people that represent the religion. What they stand for. I love them because of what they stand for and what they teach, because I love their knowledge. I love what? Their knowledge. First and foremost, it is about the knowledge, dear brothers and sisters. It's about understanding the Imam, what message he's giving to us. Allah Azza wa Jal, see, this heart of ours cannot be controlled. Listen to me very carefully. Our hearts cannot be controlled through force. Parents, sometimes we think by forcing our children into something, we can get them to do it and love doing it. No. You will never get your child to love doing something, and you will never get your child and grab his or her heart by forcing them. Let us remember the 12th Holy Imam by reciting a salawat, rising up and moving forward, please. Here Allah Azza wa Jal said, قَدْ تَبَيَّنَ الرُّشْدُ مِنَ الْغَيْ. The clear road and the course, the right course, is very clear to you from falsehood. Why? لا إكراه في الدين. And let me ask you, when we read in the Holy Quran, we see that Allah Azza wa Jal in many different places of the Holy Quran, He shows us there is an effect for our acts of worship. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. When you pray, what will happen as a result? You will be finding in yourself the ability to repulse and reject corruption and wrongdoing. True prayers does this to the soul. Why? It becomes an engagement of the soul. Allah Azza wa Jal in another place says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, it was ordained on you to fast as it was ordained on those before you, so you may become what? Pious. So here, the act of worship called fasting helps us in our piety.
So when I want to engage in an act of worship, dear brothers and sisters, there's a purpose embedded in that act. So when I want someone to be religious, how can I achieve that by forcing him or her to be religious? How can I push them and force them into it when in reality there is no compulsion in religion? Now, does it mean that I, when my 9-year-old kid or 10-year-old kid comes to me and tells me, "Mom, Dad, I don't want to pray," I say, "Okay, I'm very liberal. I would like to keep it up to you. So when you grow up, you find your own way." Sounds good, right? Very liberating. Well, do that to him or her when he tells you, "Mom, I don't want to attend school too. I don't want to go to school." Oh yeah, act liberal too. Say, "Okay, hon, stay home." Why? Now let me ask you. See, would the Department of Education or what do they call the social services be lenient with a parent when they come to you because your child has been missing from school for several days? Well, I really don't want to push and force my children to go to school. What do they tell you? No, it's not up to you. Actually, you lose custody of your children. Why? Because you're not fit. Here, suddenly, there were some standards that we could not compromise when it came to issues of education. So why, when it comes to issue of religion, we cannot tell our children that you ought to do A, B, and C? But hold on, this might be a conflict of what I said earlier. We said there is no compulsion in religion. Hold on, if there is no compulsion in religion, but yet you're telling me I should force my children to pray and fast, and maybe for the girls to put the hijab on, and maybe for the, see how I slide this very quickly, and maybe for the guys, for example, to pray on time, and maybe for them to fast, and. Hold on, I'm a little bit confused here. Should I or should I not? Let me tell you, dear brothers and sisters, your job is not going to be to make your child religious. As much as you can, you're limited. Your job is to present religion to him or her, educate them, and when they grow up, you'll see the result of your work. Meaning what? I think sometimes if I force my child, I can make them religious. No, I can't. All I can do is educate them to be religious. All I can do is show them it through example, show them it through explaining and reasoning to tap into what? That heart of theirs. How do I make my children reject religion? How do I make them hate coming to the majalis? How do I make them hate praying? First of all, when I don't do it and I tell them to do it. I see this very prevalent, by the way. It's very common the parents tell the children to do something and they themselves don't do it. That's, a very obvious hypocrisy. I mean, the children are smart. If it's that good, you do it first. Also, dear brothers and sisters, we cannot say, this is one thing, I hear it over and over again, I am not going to push my child to do A, B, and C. Part of education is to make them go through the experience. Yes, you ought to make them go through the experience. You have to encourage them to go through the experience. You have to push them to go through the experience. I cannot say, no, I don't want them to pray right now. When they're ready, they're going to pray. I go back to the same thing and say, can you say when they're ready, they're going to go to school? No, you have to do it. Now, yes, you try so much, but they grow up and they end up being non-religious. As soon as they get, quote unquote, their freedom, they left you and they escaped your hands. At that point, it's not yours. You tried your best. As long as you tried, effectively tried, you are not responsible to make you try as much as possible. The heart, their heart, is not yours. You cannot force that heart. All you can do is, it tried to convince that heart. It tried to make that heart fall in love.
With religion, of course.
It tried to make that heart love the principle. How can I make my children love something I don't love? How can, and you know what, honestly, there is magic to this religion. There is magic to Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. All you need to do is love them. When you love them, believe it or not, your children will become lovers of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. The poet, I might have recited this before to you, that the poet says, every time I mention the name of Ali, I see my heart, my soul so joyful. نفسي بذكر علي المرتضى طربت والناس من فرط إخلاصي له عجبت. And people were surprised. I am so infatuated with the love of Imam Ali. لا عذب الله. You want to know the reason? لا عذب الله أمي إنها شربت. May Allah never punish my mother. Why? Because she drank what? حب الوصي وغذتنيه باللبني. She drank the love of Ali and she fed it through her milk to me. وَإِنَّ لِي أَبَي يَهْوَى أَبَى حَسَنِي. And I have a father that is infatuated with the love of Imam Ali. فَصُرْتُ مِنْدِي وَدَى. And I became from him and her. أَهْوَى أَبَى حَسَنِي. A lover of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. So this engagement of religion and in religion, dear brothers and sisters, you know, when I see my children, they are a reflection of me. As of what? Of the amount of effort I put in them. Because keep in mind that children also, and raising children is not an easy task, believe me. Not that I'm experienced, but I see others. I see others and I work with a lot of young men and women, a lot of youth, a lot of married couple, and I see their problems. I see the young generation and I see the parents and what they go through. It's not an easy job. Some people think we get married and that's it. No, it's not. That's it. If we want to really take the issue of religion seriously, if we want to take the issue of religion seriously, dear brothers and sisters, we ought to take the issue of preparing for the 12th Holy Imam alayhi salam seriously. And if we want to do that, we need to realize, dear brothers and sisters, in order for us to prep for the appearance of the Holy Imam, now that we have talked about the Imam alayhi salam's appearance, and now that we talked about there is no compulsion in religion, we realize the Imam alayhi salam, at the time of his appearance, you think that he will be taking over just by military might. How would he grab the hearts of the people? How would he change the minds of the people? That's the might of the Imam alayhi salam. That's the power of the Imam alayhi salam. And when we see, Allah Azza wa Jal says, because when we have the ability of the mind and the ability of the heart, the mind thinks, but the heart loves. And the heart hates. The mind thinks about the issue, analyzes the issue, and comes with the conclusion. It's the heart that moves the results of the mind to be applied in the world. And how can that heart be taken, and how can that heart fall in love with the 12th Holy Imam alayhi salam? And you will find our biggest challenge is falling in love with the Imam alayhi salam. Because once and when we are able to allow the heart to understand the knowledge of the Imam, you will truly fall in love with that knowledge. Because it was made and wired for all of us. But we need to understand it. We need to take the time to understand that knowledge. And dear brothers and sisters, as a result, this is all that we're doing here. And I want to emphasize, in the past nights, what have I been talking about? How do we protect that knowledge? How the institutions, I want to repeat this over and over again. What do we channel all our resources for? All our money, all our wealth, all our power, to do what? To protect that knowledge, because it's that pure knowledge that will take hold of our hearts. We want our children to be protected. Dear brothers, dear sisters, protect the knowledge. You want them not to be misled, protect the knowledge. And you will see our maraja, our jurists, will stand up so firm against any deviations and anyone it tries to hijack the knowledge. And you will see them going to the nth degree. Why? Because that is the inheritance of the prophets, the inheritance of the apostles of God, the inheritance of the imama. That is what they are to protect, the knowledge. The communities around the United States, dear brothers and sisters, are wealthy communities. Wealthy not only with financial might, but with the thinking might, with the ability to think, with the ability to mobilize. Dear brothers and sisters, let me ask you, if we have that knowledge, if we have that key, if we are so fortunate to have it, why in the world we are still failing? Yeah, we are failing. Don't tell me we're not. Failing in what sense? Not that we're not meeting the minimum standards. Minimum standards in the eyes of Ahlul Bayt and the Shia of Ahlul Bayt, that's failure. We need to rise. We need to be successful. We need to be the ones leading the communities. We need to be the ones changing the communities. We need to be the ones giving solutions. If we have knowledge, we have solutions. Why is it we don't have it? You know why? Because we talk about the knowledge, but we never tap into it. We talk about the knowledge, we don't really study it. We talk about the knowledge, we don't put the effort into trying to understand it. It's only now recent that we see some of our youth, our successful youth, the ones who graduated from the best universities, are going to the Islamic seminaries. For what purpose? Just so they can learn the knowledge and come back with it. Because I don't care what you tell me, as much as you want to learn from the internet, from reading a book or two, you will not become an expert in that knowledge. To become an expert in that knowledge, you need to take it from the fountainhead. You need to go to the Islamic seminary itself, learn under the tutelage of the experts, and then come and face the challenges of today. How many people, how many scholars do we have today in America, in the United States of America who are truly learned, who have put the time and effort that they can face and they can provide solutions to the American people, because if we have the knowledge, we should be able to solve the problems of the people. The problem is what? We do have some scholars. I'm not saying we don't have, but we do not have those who truly were grown up here, understand the culture, understand the tradition, understand the American mind, and understand also what is given to us in our hawzat, and that true knowledge to bridge the gap and to bridge between these two civilizations to give the solution. And that is where we need to support. And this is what I have been talking in the past few nights about, different projects our communities need to truly back up and need to truly do. When you have children, don't make your child's mind only understand success if he or she becomes a doctor or becomes an engineer or becomes... No, also tell him to be truly successful is to become a scholar. And a scholar of this religion. Someone who understands and protects that religion. Someone who becomes like Habib ibn Mudahir. You think our scholars are not like Habib ibn Mudahir, are not like Al-Hur? They are the ones who are right now leading on behalf of the Imam alayhi salam. They're assisting the 12th holy Imam alayhi salam. Don't undermine, do not take what the scholars do lightly. It's a great weight they're taking on their behalf, and they're trying to carry the message. Look at our jurists everywhere, along history, from the time of the occultation, starting with the Shaykh al-Kulayni, Shaykh al-Saduq, Shaykh al-Mufid, Shaykh al-Tusi, Alam al-Huda, Al-Sharif al-Murtada, Al-Allam al-Hilli, Al-Muhaqq al-Hilli. Have you heard of these names going down all the way, Al-Wahid al-Bahbahani, At-Sayyid al-Taba'i, Al-Sheikh Kashif al-Ghita, all the way moving down, and I'm just mentioning the names, there are many of them. These are the scholars running through Sheikh al-Ansari, Al-Akhund al-Khurasani, and all of them. They are the ones that protected the knowledge and the religion under the leadership of the 12th Holy Imam alayhi salam. This is what we need to study. This is what we need to learn. Dear brothers and sisters, we need to channel our efforts. We need to channel our efforts to support these kind of systems, these kind of projects. We need to make sure that we're doing something like this. Again and again, I want to repeat it. The effects of the podium of Muharram is that in 10, 12 years, we cannot be standing here again talking about the same problems. We cannot. I can tell you about the history. I can talk to you more about the details of Shafa'a, Tawassul, etc. But you know what's important? Those are important issues. But what's important that we know what we ought to do to protect that knowledge. How we move forward to protect that knowledge. You know how I always love when I listen to and I read the majalis for? Amongst the many, Al-Hur. You know why I love Al-Hur al-Riyahi? See, other companions of the Imam Ali, Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, were with the Imam. They chose where they stand, on the camp of the Imam Husayn alayhi salam. Al-Hur, though, it started with a different camp. Al-Hur, he is the one who stopped the Imam, salamullahi ta'ala alayh. Al-Hur, he's the one that prevented the Imam from going anywhere. Al-Hur is the one with the 1,000 soldiers. He stopped the Imam, alayhi salam, but it was the Hur. They say, dear brothers and sisters, let us go to the battlefield of Karbala, to the 10th day of Muharram, when the two camps, the two armies stood right in facing one and the other. They said, Umar ibn Sa'd wanted to initiate the battle. They say, Al-Hur looked at Umar ibn Sa'd. He told him, Ya Umar, are you truly fighting this man? He said, Wallah, if your prince allows us, I would not. But he says, we have to, so therefore I will. Dear brothers and sisters, it was in that moment, it was at that time that Al-Hur was seen to be looking back and forth from the camp of Imam Hussein alayhi salam to the camp of Umar ibn Sa'd. At that moment, Al-Hur had such a shiver. They say, dear brothers and sisters, one of his friends looked at him. He told him, Ya Hur, if I would have not known any better, if I were asked who is the most courageous of the people and the warriors of Kufa, I would have chosen you. Ya Hur, why is it that you are shivering? Why is it that I see you doing this? He said, Wallah, inni ukhayyiru nafsi bain al-jannati wan-nar. I am giving myself the choice between heaven and hell. Wallah, I shall choose nothing over heaven. And they say, he looked at his son. Some of those who narrate the Masa'ib say, he looked at his son Ali. He told him, Ya Ali, come with me. And they both rushed all the way to the camp of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Now come with me. How did Al-Hur approach the camp? They say, Al-Hur, this man who reveres Imam Hussein alayhi salam, who loves Imam Hussein alayhi salam, they say he dismounted himself from the horse. His head was down, his eyes cast it down, walked slowly to the holy Imam. The Imam looked at him. He said, Al-Hur told the Imam, Sayyidi, I am the one who stopped you in Karbala. I am the one who scared the woman and the children. Sayyidi, anywhere is there a way for me to repent? Is there a way for me to seek forgiveness? They say, Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam, look at that loving heart. He said, Ya Wallah, Ya Hur, there is repentance, Ya Hur, there is forgiveness, Ya Hur. And they say, as Ibn Sa'd was trying to start the battle, they never actually started fighting in the battlefield until Al-Hur asked Imam Hussein alayhi salam the permission to go and fight in the battlefield. They say Al-Hur went into the battlefield. He tried to advise and tell the people, the enemies of Allah. No one would listen to him. They attacked him. They say at least 40 were wounded or killed. And others say about 80 were wounded and killed by Al-Hur alone. They could not fight him. They could not fight him man to man. So they started throwing him with arrows and attacking him with stones and rocks until the Hur was attacked by so many from around him. Dear brothers and sisters, when Al-Hur fell on the grounds of Karbala, what was the last words he said? As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdillah al-Hussein. They say, his son Ali followed in his footsteps, and they say his brother Mus'ab followed in his footsteps. Dear brothers and sisters, another companion of Imam Hussein, who do we go to? Let us go to Habib ibn Muzahir. Now Habib, before he goes, as he stood before Imam Hussein, they say when Habib stood before Imam Hussein alayhi salam, Imam Hussein saw Habib with the tears in his eyes. He said, Imam Hussein told Habib, Habib, you might be missing the family, you might be missing the children. Ya Habib, why don't you go back? Habib said to Imam Hussein, it is not for them I cry. Al-Imam al-Hussein looked at Habib, said, what are these tears for? Habib said, the tears are because of the woman standing behind. And Imam Hussein turns, and there was Lady Zainab right by the tent. Who would take care of her? Ah, dear brothers and sisters, companion after companion would go to the battlefield, and upon them falling on the grounds of Karbala, they would say the last farewell to Imam Hussein. As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdillah. Dear brothers and sisters, one last companion, Abbas was so in love with Imam Hussein. The heart of his was full of the love of Hussein alayhi salam. Dear brothers and sisters, Abbas, he was known to be a strong warrior. He went to the battlefield. No one was able to fight Abbas. No one was able to fight Abbas one-on-one. They say Abbas dismounted himself off the horse. He started calling them, come and fight me. What is wrong with you people? They would run away until Abbas let go of his sword. He approached them with his bare hands. They told him, ya Abbas, did you go insane? He said, Ewallah, the love of Hussein, Hubbul Hussein, Ajannani, la talumuni. The love of Hussein is drove me insane. Don't blame me. Sayyidi ya Hussein. They say Imam Hussein on the 10th day of Muharram in the land of Karbala, he stood on the plain fields of Karbala calling, ya Habib, ya Muslim, ya Zuhair, where are you? Why don't you answer me? حبيبي حسين نور عيني حسين غريب كربلاء مظلوم كربلاء شهيد كربلاء سيدي يا حسين. Everyone together, let us call Imam Hussein عليه السلام. يا حسين يا حسين. Again, يا حسين ya Hussein. One more time, everyone. Ya Hussein, ya Hussein. بحق الحسين يا الله. Accept the little we offer. Cleanse us, ya Allah. Forgive us, ya Allah. Show us the path, O Almighty God. بحق محمد وآل محمد. Accept the little we offer. بحق محمد وآل محمد. And accept the blessings and let us send the blessings of reciting Surah Al-Fatiha for the souls of all the deceased one after Salat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجن حسين سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجن حسين سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجن King of martyrs, O Imam of man and jinn, Mawla Hussein. King of martyrs, O Imam of man and jinn, Mawla Hussein. Marhaba ya Aba Abdullah, ya Aba Akbar Hussein. Warithul Adam, Abul Ahrar, Imami ya Hussein. Father of infants, Abdullah and Ali Akbar Hussein. O inheritor of Adam, father of freedom, Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجن حسين سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجن حسين King of martyrs, O Imam of man and jinn, Mawla Hussein King of martyrs, O Imam of man and jinn أنك أقمت الصلاة أنك أتيت الزكاة أنك أقمت الصلاة أنك أتيت الزكاة قد أمرت بالمعروف ونهيت المنكرات قد أمرت بالمعروف ونهيت المنكرات You established prayer and gave in charity, Mawla Hussein. You enjoined the right forbidden equity, Mawla Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجن حسين سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجن حسين King of martyrs, O Imam of man and jinn, Mawla Hussein King of martyrs, O Imam of man and jinn, Mawla Hussein الحسين من نكالا وأنا من الحسين أنت سيد أهل الجنة والسفينة يا حسين مصطفى said you are from me I from you my son Hussein Prince of Paradise, you are a sanctuary, my son Hussein. Ya Hussein, 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 Ya Hussein. سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجنة حسين سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجنة حسين King of martyrs, O Imam of man and jinn, Mawla Hussein King of martyrs, O Imam of
man and jinn, Mawla Hussein
مرحبا يا طار الله خيرة الله مصطفى أنت نفس المطمئنة أنت مصباح الهدى Your avenger is Allah Your selector is Allah Your contented soul a lamp of guidance in every era Ya Hussein, 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 Ya Hussein,
سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجنة حسين سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجنة حسين King of martyrs, O Imam of man and jinn, Mawla Hussein King of martyrs, O Imam of
man and jinn, Mawla Hussein
السلام عليك يا ابن المصطفى والمرتضى السلام عليك يا ابن المصطفى والمرتضى مرحبا يا ابن الخديجة نور عين الفاطمة مرحبا يا ابن الخديجة نور عين الفاطمة Salutations to the son of Mustafa and Murtaza. Salutations to the son of Mustafa and Murtaza. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein. سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجنة حسين سيد الشهداء إمام الإنس والجنة حسين King of martyrs, O Imam of man and jinn, Mawla Hussein King of martyrs, O Imam of man and jinn, Mawla Hussein
Ya Hussein
Ya Hussein Y'all say.